are here this morning, let's stand together. As we prepare, let's get our hearts ready for worship with the time of prayer. Lord, thank you for this day. Lord, we thank you that you love us. We thank you for the opportunity we have to gather in this place to come and sing praises to you, Lord. We just look forward to singing our praises this morning. May you be honored and glorified. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Thank you. His body that was broken and his blood that was shed. We pray now that you're taking this communion, this come into our heart even more. Fill the void, Father, and prepare us for your kingdom. In your Son's precious name.
Amen.
Please don't eat any water.
Holy God, we thank you for this day. Lord, we thank you that you love us, that you care for us, Lord, that you know us by name. And Lord, we just thank you for this opportunity we have to come and to worship you in a different way now, Lord, as we come to bring our gifts of tithes and offering to you, Lord, that you have ordained in our hearts to give. Lord, may you use those to further your kingdom, to further your work here on this earth. We love you, we thank you, and praise the name of Jesus, for it's in your name we pray. Amen. As offerings being passed, we have a celebration. We'd like you to walk into this. Children's Church. The rest of us are going to turn in our Bibles to Philippians chapter 3. Thank you, Kyle. Appreciate that. I'll explain later if I need to. I'm named after, in my middle, my name's Stephen Floyd. The Floyd comes from my grandpa Floyd. My grandpa Floyd was a different guy. He had a lot of fun. He worked a lot of different jobs in his life, from coal miner to bootlegger to a PI. Just being real. Private investigator. He was in his 60s, near 70. He got his private investigator license. And then he would offer security for people. And he had an old bus. Back before it was cool to have a motorhome you traveled in and stuff and lived in, he was like one of the pioneers of that. He took an old bus and he made it into an RV. And he put a range in it and bunk beds in it. He had a wood stove right behind the driver's seat. And he lived in that bus. And he offered protection and security for a family who was very wealthy, who had a house and some properties on Lake Cumberland. And one of the perks of the job was he was able to park his bus on Lake Cumberland, which was like a dream come true for him because he loved to trap and fish and hunt. And he lived off the land often. And everything was going great for Grandpa, but then he had a health problem in his 70s. And he needed to be closer to family. And so my dad and my mom, they went down to Lake Cumberland. The old bus wasn't running, but Dad got it running, and they drove it back to Indiana over to Dad and Mom's little farm over by Madison, Indiana, and they parked the bus there, and Grandpa then lived in the bus there on our farm. Now, he liked it there, but it wasn't Lake Cumberland, you know? He liked the water, and there wasn't good fishing holes close by, and he didn't drive himself, so it was he was kind of a duck out of water there. So eventually he moved over to a place my uncle had on his lake. It was just a shack, but it was on the water, and that's all he cared about. But he left his bus at the farm. So then we would go over, and if we were cutting firewood or working on the farm for a couple days, we would stay in the old bus, and we loved it. We'd get a good fire roaring in there, and in the evening time, our only lights were lanterns, and we would pile in those bunk beds, chase all the snakes out first, of course, and we would stay there in that bus overnight, and we just loved it. And best of all about that old bus is it still had the steering wheel, the shifter, and the pedals. The seat was no more, but it did have the shifter, the pedals, and the seat. And I would drive that bus everywhere. Now the bus, the tires were rotted off of it. It didn't run. It couldn't move it. You had to have a bulldozer to move it. But I drove that bus from Madison to Bedford. I drove it from Bedford, went around, picked up all my friends in it. And I drove it up to Western Skateland. We'd roller skate and have popsicles. And we'd drive it back home. And we would sing songs on the way back home. And it was all by the power of my imagination I could do that. Isn't it amazing what we can do with the power of the imagination? My prayer that I've prayed over each one of you this morning is that God would just fill your imagination with visions of heaven. That this morning you would see visions of heaven. That as you miss loved ones that are no longer here with you, that you would see visions of heaven. See, for me, the imagination allows me to drive whatever car, whatever motorcycle, whatever boat, RV, ATV, you name it. I can drive it all right up here. And as I drive it, I can hear the motor roar. My imagination never puts me in a hybrid, just going to let you know. It's never a bus. It's always a roar. It's always a... Because gas mileage doesn't matter with my imagination. But I can literally hear the RPMs roar. You know, the revolutions per minute of the motor. I can hear them roar in my imagination. You know, they say that with our minds, we think an average of 500 to 700 words per minute. That's how many words go through our minds. You know how sometimes you just get worn out sitting there? It's because you're thinking. What are you thinking about? So the RPMs are turning. They're revving. The motor's revving up. Vroom, vroom. What are you thinking about? You know, if we're all in all the time, we're thinking about Jesus minutes of that time. We're thinking about His kingdom. And we realize that we're on a road trip. We're heaven bound. The wheels are turning. The RPMs are moving. They're up there. It's tacking out because we're rejoicing in the Lord. You know, the Apostle Paul wrote the book of Philippians to the church from prison. At this point, Paul was experiencing a time of tribulation. His freedom has been taken away from him as a citizen, but yet he's free in Christ. So as he's free in Christ, even though he's a prisoner, he writes to the church about the joy, about the peace, about the contentment for those who are heaven bound, for those who are in Christ Jesus. See, his destination is in heaven. So he says to the church in verse 1, Philippians chapter 3, verse 1, whatever happens, and I believe he knows what will happen to him. I believe he knows that in a short while in the future, he'll be killed because of his faith. Yeah, he says, whatever happens, rejoice in the Lord. Whatever happens, rejoice in the Lord. I never get tired of telling you things, these things, and I do it to safeguard your faith. Paul's being persecuted because of his faith. Many of the original readers of this letter were being persecuted because of their faith, or they were facing persecution. Yet Paul says to them, rejoice in the Lord. I don't pretend to know what's going on in all your lives this morning. I know very little about what's going on in your lives, only what you share with me. But regardless of what's going on in your lives, regardless if everything's better than it's ever been before, or it's maybe worse than ever before, or times right now may be scary for you because your health is failing, or you're in a financial just real, it's just, the bubble's about to pop and not in a good way there. Or maybe you're grieving, or maybe you're worried. I believe the Lord has a word for you this morning, and here's the word. You ready? Yes. Rejoice. That's His word for you this morning. Rejoice. You may not want to rejoice right now. You may not think you want to rejoice right now. But I promise you, it's what you need. See, rejoicing is necessary if we're going to be all in all the time. In the very next chapter of Philippians, Philippians chapter 4, Paul commands the church this: rejoice in the Lord always, and again I will say, rejoice. And like Paul, we as the church this morning, we can rejoice because we're heaven bound. I mean, think about it. How do you feel whenever you book a vacation or a cruise? Well, you get pretty excited about it, don't you? Some of you go out and buy a new bathing suit. If it's winter time, maybe you go to the Tanner and you start getting a little bit so you'll fit in on the beach. You won't be out there with our Indiana pale white bodies, huh? You get all prepped and ready for the vacation you're so excited about. Maybe you even start going to the gym. Oh yeah, beach body, here we come. You're excited because you know you're going somewhere. I mean, even before you're there, when you're flying or driving there, you're happy because you have a destination in front of you. I noticed on a flight to Vegas a few years ago that everyone on the flight was excited. It was Saturday night. The flight was packed. I mean, it was a full flight. It was cramped conditions. But yet everybody on the plane was happy. They were excited. They were cheering. They were ready. Why, Vegas, here we come! The Tuesday morning flight back to Indiana had an entirely different feel. Everybody felt defeated. They were kind of dreary. A lot of people looked maybe hungover. Now, Aurora and I, we were excited. We were ecstatic because we were going home to see our kids. We visited family and went to church while we were in Vegas. They maybe did something different. Either way, we were rejoicing because we were on our way home. Friends, we have a lot to rejoice about because we're on our way home to heaven. We're heaven bound. We might be battling depression here on this earth or addiction or disappointment or heartbreak, but we can rejoice in the Lord who's overcome all of our disappointment, all of our failures, and all of our fears. After the Apostle Paul commanded the church to rejoice, he says to them something else in verse 2, and it's totally different than what he said in verse 1. Are you ready for it? Watch out for those dogs. Rejoice in the Lord. Now watch out for those dogs. Let's just say that there's some rabid dogs running around out here in Smithville. Now I have a feeling here in Smithville they would only last about 30 seconds because you guys would take care of that. And I appreciate that about you. And you're prepared right now to take care of that, aren't you? Yes, you are. But let's just say they're out there right now. What do we say? Watch out for those dogs. Paul says, watch out for those dogs, those people who do evil in this world. He's saying there's dogs out there, people who are doing evil. And notice that their dogs at that time were not like dogs. They didn't carry their dogs around as pets or put them in little bags and carry them with them. These dogs are like street creatures that are just survivors. They were kind of mangy, snarly things. I've seen some of those dogs in the streets of Mexico. You don't go up and pet those dogs. You watch out for those dogs. If one of those dogs is coming down the sidewalk, you go to the other side of the street. Watch out for those dogs. Who's he talking about? He's dealing with a specific situation in the church. There's false teachers in the church who are teaching the people it's all about what you've done and what you can do and what your salvation lies in. He says, watch out for them because they're false teachers. They're telling you to go get circumcised and do all these other things. Watch out for them because that's not what's going to get you to heaven. That's not the reason you're heaven bound. They're teaching you it's based on your works, but I'm telling you it's based on your faith. He says in verse 3, we rely on what Christ has done for us. I want you to say that with me this morning. We rely on what Christ has done for us. He continues to warn the believers about following those who put their faith in what they have done, in their works and their deeds. Oh, I've done this, and I've done this, and I've done this, and I've done this. And then verse 12, Paul moves on, and he gives the church the corrective course to rejoicing in the Lord as we're heaven bound. And this is what he says. I don't mean to say that I've already achieved these things, that I've already reached perfection, and I'm with Paul on this. Nope, not done it. But I press on to possess that perfection for which Christ Jesus first possessed me. No, dear brothers and sisters, I've not achieved it. But I focus on one thing. I love in Scripture when it says one thing. I can get that. I focus on one thing. Forgetting the past and looking forward to what lies ahead, I press on to reach the end of the race and receive the heavenly prize for which God, through Christ Jesus, is calling me. How do we live out God's word of rejoice? We press on. We forget and we forge. We press on, forgetting the past and forging forward to what lies ahead, we rejoice in the Lord. When you stop at a stoplight and you're sitting there, when the light turns green, what are you supposed to do? When you go, do you need to look in the rearview mirror through the windshield? Here's what happens. Oftentimes we come to the stoplight and we are sitting there and we get distracted. The text comes through and we're looking at the text. Maybe some of you, Andre, people are even responding to the text while you're at the stoplight. Maybe you're looking around at everybody else at the stoplight. Maybe you're looking in the rearview mirror and you're like, man, who's that guy back there picking his nose? Is that my preacher? Are you kidding me? And the light's green. What are you supposed to be doing? You're supposed to be going, but you're sitting there looking in the rearview mirror. And some of us right now, we're just idling. We're just sitting still. We're not pressing on. Why? Because we're looking in the rearview mirror. We're looking in the past. And the light is green, but we're still sitting still. And it's time to go. So let's forget about the failures in the past and let's look forward and let's hit the gas. And when you hit the gas, what happens? The RPMs start to come up. And as the RPMs start to come up, you go. And as you start to think about the future, church, instead of everything in the past, when you think about what lies ahead instead of what lies behind, when you think about the future, that in eternity, God has all eternity to make up for every brief wrong in the past, all of a sudden you're going to start moving forward. You're going to rejoice in the Lord. I promise you that. But I've made mistakes, preacher. Okay, anybody here not made a mistake? Just raise your hand right now. We'd like to applaud you. Anybody here never made a mistake? Okay, very good. All right, we got that part down. All of us here have made mistakes. But here's the truth. In Jesus Christ, we're made new and we're made righteous. My old self has been crucified with Christ and I no longer live, but Christ lives in me. So I live in this earthly body by trusting in the Son of God who loved me and gave Himself for me. And Philippians 3, 2 through 11 reminds us that we're not relying on ourselves, we're relying on Christ Jesus. And we're rejoicing because of what Jesus has done and what Jesus will continue to do. And what does Jesus do? He forgives, He frees, He fulfills, He gives us a full life. He chooses us as His very own people. The Bible says you are a chosen people. As a result, you can show others the goodness of God who's called you out of the darkness and into His marvelous light. And to walk in the light, we must forget about the dark. To walk in the light, we must forget about what we've done in the past and what others have done in the past and about the deeds of the darkness. We must forget about the past struggles and the past sins. We must forget about everything that's been done to us in the past and we must forge forward into the light. But to walk in the light, we also must forgive the past. Uh-oh, are we hearing this again? We heard this 2 weeks ago about forgiving. We're over that already. That's my sin I want to hang on to. I want to be bitter. I want to hit the replay button and go back and look in that rearview mirror and look at everything in the back that's happened and be mad about that and be mad about everybody else. It's not fair, preacher. You're right, it's not. You know what? It wasn't fair for my Savior to be nailed on a cross either, was it? But He did it because He loves you. He did it because He doesn't want you trapped in the darkness. So I focus on one thing. I forget about the past and I forge forward to the future. I forge forward to the light. Paul Rick gave a great meditation a few weeks ago on the importance of when you're driving to look through the windshield instead of looking in the mirror. Some of us are not only looking in the mirror this morning, we have the car in reverse and we have it hammered down, replaying everything, squealing the tires. I remember one time at a church event as a teenager, the youth minister wasn't real responsible and didn't take everybody's keys from them at the beginning of the overnight thing. Note to self, looking forward, always take the keys from the kids if you're having an overnight thing at the church. The reason you want to do that is because Aaron and Chris decided to drag race that night. And Aaron had a pretty awesome split bumper Camaro Z28. You with me? It was sweet. Chris had a Chevelle. They were out there in the church parking lot, and it turned a little bit before it got to the road, and they had a drag race. And Aaron beat Chris. Chris was a little bit fired up with it, and he threw it in reverse, and he showed us how he could smoke the tires in reverse. As he was smoking the tires in reverse, looking in the mirror, he forgot about the light pole, and he hit it. Chris then just went on home. He drove home. Never fessed up to it. My dad just found out during the first service that's what happened to the light pole. Because he was the preacher at the church, and they were drilling, "What happened to the light pole? What light? We had a light pole out there?" It was all hanging over like this. I can tell you something. When you're smoking the tires in reverse, you're going to hit something. When you're always driving in reverse, you're going to hit something. I don't care if you have a backup camera or not. Your car's not designed to be always driving in reverse. I'm going to tell you, you're not designed to always be in reverse either. And this morning, if you're in reverse and you're hitting the replay button and you're playing back all the bad deeds done in the dark, you need to hit the brakes right now. You need to put the car in drive and you need to look forward. You need to let the RPMs of your mind go forward instead of in reverse. You need to press on and receive the heavenly prize for which God through Christ Jesus is calling us. See, God is calling us to forge forward, church. To look to the heavenly prize. Since you've been raised to a new life in Christ, your sights should be set on the realities of heaven where Christ sits at the place of honor at God's right hand. Think about these things in heaven, not the things of this earth. See, reality is when we're thinking back and we're always looking back to the dark, what we think about? We're thinking about ourselves and we're thinking about this earth. Forge forward. The Bible says, rev the RPMs of your minds. By rejoicing, forgetting, and forging. Set your minds on the destination. Let that imagination go on the destination. Look at verse 18. For I told you before, and I say it again with tears in my eyes. Again, he's pleading with the folks. With tears in my eyes, I write this to you. That there are many whose conduct shows they are really enemies of the cross of Christ. They're headed for destruction. Their God is their appetite. And they brag about shameful things. And they think only about this life here on this earth. Church, people whose destination is destruction only think about life on this earth. They only think about, get this, they only think about what they want. And the Bible says if we're only thinking about life on this earth and we're only thinking about what we want in this life, then we're enemies of the cross. It would be a dreadful thing to hear from God that I'm an enemy of the cross. Yet the truth is that if I'm depending on my own good deeds to get to heaven, if I'm seeking what I want instead of what God wants for my life, and if I'm thinking only of this earth and not of heaven, my destination, the reality is I'm an enemy of the cross, and an enemy of the cross is an enemy of God. But thank God. That's not who we are anymore, because all of us, we've made mistakes. We've been enemies of the cross. You were His enemies. God separated from Him by your evil thoughts and actions. Yet now He's reconciled you to Himself through the death of Christ in His physical body. As a result, He's brought you into His own presence. Now listen to this part. This is what gets me. So I was an enemy of God, but I'm completely restored to God, and I stand in His presence, and you stand in His presence if you're in Christ, holy and blameless as you stand before Him without a single fault. Even Chris, for backing into that pole, stands before God, because I know Chris and he's in Christ. He stands before God without any fault. The light pole's forgotten. The unsafe driving's forgotten. Us lying there about us not knowing what's happened, it's forgotten. And so today we can rejoice in the Lord. We can forge forward with our minds on the destination. Verse 20. Why? Because we're citizens of heaven where the Lord Jesus Christ lives. Listen, I'm grateful for my citizenship here in the United States of America. It's a wonderful place to live. It is. It's good. Life's good here. But this isn't my home. And I hope it's not your home. Let me tell you about my home. My home's not this physical realm. Right now, I stand here before you with pain right here because I have this thing called pleurisy. Have you ever had that? That's why Kyle had to get me some water. I accidentally took that pill you're supposed to take without eating anything this morning, and it was beginning to make my stomach do some things. Oh, man, this is not good. So Aurora gave me some crackers, and Kyle gave me some water. And in my home, at my home, that's never going to happen. And in our home, at our destination, you're not going to feel that sadness that you feel here on this earth when you think about loved ones that you miss. And in our home in heaven, it's not affected by what's popular here on this earth or what some Hollywood person says. It's not affected by what the majority thinks or feels. It's not affected by any sickness that can come upon you. It's not affected by any terrorist scheme. It isn't affected by government shutdowns. It isn't affected by who's in office. It isn't affected by Republicans or Democrats or independents. It's not affected by any of that. See, my home in heaven is a place where we're not ever going to experience any heartbreak, any hurt, any pain, any betrayal, any bitterness, any hate, any temptations, any sin, any bullies. Can you imagine? Can you let your RPMs of your mind just go right now and imagine this place outside this physical realm that we have called heaven? Don Piper's been to the gate. He's a preacher, and he was in a terrible car accident in Alabama. And while he was in the car accident, he died there at the scene. He was pronounced dead for 90 minutes. And this is what he recounts about just glimpsing in the gates of heaven. Would you shut your eyes for a minute and just think about this? A light engulfed me with a brilliance beyond description, and joy filled me as I looked around, and I became aware of a large crowd of people in front of a brilliant ornate gate, and I wasn't conscious of anything I'd left behind, and I felt no regrets about leaving family or possessions. See, we miss them. But the reality is, they don't miss us because time hasn't even moved for them, because time doesn't even exist. Even though we have clocks all around us ticking up here, they're outside of that realm. And everyone was more radiant and joyful than ever on earth. And a holy awe came over me as I stepped forward, and then I heard the music, and sounds filled my mind and heart. And hundreds of songs were being sung at the same time, and I heard them from every direction and realized that each voice praised God, and every sound blended, and each voice or instrument enhanced all the others. And all the praises were about Christ's reign as King of Kings and how wonderful He is. And the gate glowed and it shimmered, and I paused just outside the gate, and I could see inside, and it was like a city with streets paved with gold bricks, and everything I saw was bright, and the brightest of colors my eyes had ever seen. I continued to step closer to the gate, and my friends and relatives were all in front of me, calling, urging, and inviting me to follow. The music increased. The closer we got, the more intense, alive, and vivid everything became. As I reached the gate, I paused and I wanted to go inside. I knew everything would be even more thrilling than what I experienced thus far. Then, just as suddenly as I had arrived at the gates of heaven, I left them. You can open your eyes. Don left the gates of heaven because there was another man, a Christian, there who climbed into the wreckage of his car and had his hand on his shoulder and was praying for him. And praying for God to spare his life. A man who was singing songs over him. What a friend we have in Jesus. And so Don returned to the wreckage of his mangled body. And there he realized that he was in a bad place. And his road to recovery has been difficult. But he also realized that God called him back to this earth to tell his story. So he's told his story over and over again to anybody that'll listen. He wrote the book, 90 Minutes in Heaven. because he wants everyone to saw what he saw at the gates of the destination. He just peeked in. He didn't get a go. He just peeked in. And he reminds believers that God will take our weak, immortal bodies and change them into glorious bodies like his own, using the same power with which he will bring everything under his control. Can you imagine? I mean, Don just peeked inside the gates. Can you imagine? My grandpa's there. And you know, whenever Kirby was playing Beulah Land in the first service, and then again in the second service, I went back to that old green bus. While I was standing right up here, I went back to that old green bus. And I was driving it down those streets of gold. That's where I went in my imagination. The RPMs of my mind were going. And I was back in Grandpa's old bus. And I was grabbing gears. And tears come over me, but not tears of sadness, but tears of joy. And others that I miss so much, and that you miss so much, they were in the bus with me. And they were telling me what all lies ahead. I can't even imagine what it's really going to be like. The Bible says no eye has seen, no ear has heard, no mind has conceived, but God has prepared for those who love him. And as fun as it is to drive Grandpa's old bus, I'm kind of driving it now just to let you know. We're all in there. It's a little tight, but we're all in there. It's just a 3-speed. We're not going real fast. But we're not in a hurry because we're in heaven. We're not worried because we're in heaven. No one's sick because we're in heaven. No one's grieving because we're in heaven. Can you imagine? Grandpa's bus didn't have a seat in it anymore, so I had to stand and hang on that wheel as I shifted and drove. It's kind of hard, but now it's not because I'm in heaven. Oh, I hope you're there with me. Hope you're there with me. Grandpa's bus isn't the way, though. Grandpa's bus can't get you to heaven. It's sitting in the woods about 60 miles from here. Trees have grown up all around it. I don't even know if we can get in it anymore. It can't get you to heaven. But Jesus can. And the night Jesus would be arrested, and the day before he would be beaten and crucified, he knew that his disciples were going to see some horrific things in the future. And this is what he said. He said, "Don't let your hearts be troubled. Don't let me be troubled. Trust in God. Trust also in me. For in my Father's house there are many rooms. If it were not so, I would not have told you. And I'm going there to prepare a place for you." Just imagine Jesus telling each one of them as he paused right there for you. I'm going there to prepare a place for you. If it were not so, I would not have told you. And I'm going there, and I will come back to take you where I am. You know the way. Thomas still hadn't caught on. "We don't know where you're going, so how can we know the way, Jesus?" Kyle, Jesus said, "I am the way, the truth, and the life. No one comes to the Father except through me." We know that salvation is found under no other name under heaven. There's no other name in which we must be saved. How do we get there? Jesus, that's how we get there. Not the gold green bus, Jesus. Jesus said, "Whoever believes and is baptized will be saved. Whoever does not believe will be condemned." See, I've realized that in my last days here on this earth, all I am is a travel agent. That's what I am. I'm a travel agent. And I just ask you this morning, have you made your preparations to go to the destination? And if you have, I pray this morning in this next song that you will just escape and drive and ride in Grandpa's old green bus or whatever it is that lets you drive on those streets of gold. Maybe you don't walk so good right now. If that's you, you run down those streets of gold during this next song. Maybe you've never been able to dance very good on this earth. I'm with you. It's tough. Imagine being married in a Mexican family, okay? Because all of them can dance. But in heaven, I'm going to dance like no other. And then we have this next song. I just ask you to let those RPMs roar. And imagine. And if you've not made those preparations, as we stand, you come to the front. And let's make sure that we have everything right and everything in order as we rely on Jesus. Amen. We're going to stand, and if you have any decision, you come to the front. Let's imagine.
I can only imagine what it will be like when I walk by your side. Only imagine what my eyes will see when your face is before me. I can only imagine.
Debating with philosophies here on this earth, but instead we'll just share our visions of heaven. We'll share about life in the kingdom of heaven. We won't spend our time discussing and debating in the deeds of the dark, but we will focus ourselves on heaven as we press on to our heavenly prize. And may we be interested in sharing Jesus, who is the way to heaven. For we know whoever believes and calls upon the name of Jesus will be saved.
Amen.
Lord, we thank you for the way. We thank you that you didn't make it complicated. You made it really, really simple. Thank you. And we live now to rejoice in your name and hear your church today as we say, amen.
Amen.
God bless you. You have a great day. We'll see you later.